The topic aims to establish a link between the prominent features of vernacular architectural strategies with the sustainability and how they can be incorporated with the modern technologies to develop a healthy living condition. Based on the Indian philosophy, the void is considered to be the source of highest energy. And the Vastu Shastra is basically implemented since the earlier times to design dwellings and different spatial arrangements in a built environment. The topic talks about like how the strategies that vernacular architecture implemented in the earlier times, which are being extinct as modernization is taking over. So, how these strategies, in accordance to the modern technology, can be implemented in the present day to create more efficient built structure? So, what do we understand by vernacular architecture, sustainability, and identity? Well, vernacular architecture is the climatically and culturally approved design and strategies that were implemented in the earlier times when the technology did not take over. Vernacular architecture, sustainability, and identity, these three are closely linked to each other, inseparably linked. They are codependent and they fit into the concept of the triple bottom line as well. So the term sustainability recently gained prominence, and the major focus with sustainability is to maintain a balance between the built and the unbuilt. And these were even practiced when the technology did not take over. The rural to urban migration somehow influenced a switch from the traditional to the modern strategies, which led to the vernacular identity of the region, of different regions in India, almost oblivious in the present day, and they are losing their existence. So, what can we do to resolve such a situation? What is the solution to the problem that we are facing in hand, and how do we manage to get it done? Like, what should the approach be? Well, the answer would be to be able to use a reverse migration approach by sustainable rural development. By using the objectives, aims and objectives of sustainable development, which is integration between green belt and agriculture, giving new value to agricultural landscape, improving rural economic system, and then improving the network between the ecosystem and the biodiversity, then creating new identity and ecological richness, then improving the quality of rural production activities and products, promoting the wellness of citizens of the rural community and others as well, and enhancement of the existing built structures. So how do we achieve all that? Well, another approach could be to promote a smart growth, like mixed-use community and development in such a way that would discourage the sprawling situation that currently we are facing. To move further in this direction, there are several questions that we need to ask ourselves before we proceed. So let's take a look at those questions. The questions that we need to ask ourselves today is what would influence us to either opt for modern architecture or the traditional architecture? How can we achieve a balance between the two? And is it possible to create a fusion between the traditional and the modern architecture? Now the real question arises that if it is possible, and if we began to do that, fusing traditional and vernacular and modern, then what difference would it make in terms of rural development? Would it really make architecture and community more sustainable? And most importantly, even if the architects go for a blend, for a fusion, so would the users, the community, would they accept the design? Would they go for it? Or it would just be a vision that architects have for a future development, for a sustainable development? Coming to this slide, we can see the undulating landscape here, and it could be easily recognizable that the landscape shows the city of Rajasthan. The cultural aspect, the illustration clearly fits the line of the infrastructural, cultural, and architectural relationship between different elements in the picture. The contextual landscape, they also shows that how the vernacular elements in architecture clearly defines the inclusivity in the community, which somehow we lack in modern architecture, to be honest. And also the elements, even if we can see different boxes, but the architectural elements like the windows and doors, they can clearly and easily distinguish it from other vernacular buildings. We can easily recognize that this is the architecture of Rajasthan. And suppose if it were glass facades or anything as such, it would have been difficult to analyze identify that which place we are talking about. In the next illustration, which is a building facade, we can clearly see how the community interacts and how the architecture actually works in bringing the community together to develop a sense of belonging within them. Now we have analyzed Rajkumari Ratnavati Girls School, which is located in Rajasthan. The reason for this case study is because it is a modern building and which implements vernacular strategies, the local techniques, to create a architectural marvel in a desert. So the analysis of the structure was mainly done on the basis of the LEED credit categories, which is sustainable site and locations, water efficiency, energy and atmosphere, materials and resources, and regional priority. So coming to the location of the site, the structure is located approximately 6 kilometer drive away from the Sam Sand Dunes in Jaisalmer, and it is built in the village of Kanoi, right at the center of the desert. And the location provides a direct connectivity from a transport facility, which is easy for the crowd to travel to this place and to travel from this place to another. And another thing that we can see is this school is part of a Gyan Kendra. So somehow the reason why it has been built in such a way so that it could also be a place for tourist attraction. And the undulating landscapes somehow have been preserved when the architect Diana Clogg retained the native trees. The trees that were found around the site, they were retained and they were utilized in such a way so that they become an element of attraction for the children, where they can play and sit in the shade, anything as such. The design of the structure creates a safe space, an enclosure, and it protects the interior from the harsh climate and the desert wind. Coming to the indoor environment quality, the indoor environment quality is maintained using the vernacular architectural elements like small windows and trying to incorporate natural light in the interiors, the diffuse light basically, so that the building does not gain heat. And the entire system of the school is to maintain a sustainable environment. They did not use a mechanical cooling system for the same, and the external facade is a latticed wall or a traditional jali with the purpose of creating these stack effects and allowing for natural light and ventilation, along with keeping away the harsh sun and wind of the desert climate. The flow pattern inside the building cools the interior, and small transom windows are created along the near the ceiling to get more natural light into the classrooms that would create a very pleasant environment for the children. The structure also meets the requirements of being a water efficient structure that and the courtyard incorporates the design of the courtyard incorporates water harvesting strategies and has a cistern in the middle which can harvest approximately 3.5 liter a lakh liter of water and stores in its belly at the very same time. The water collected as it runs off the catchment area, and the collected water is transported through a system of gutters and downpipes for storage. Coming to energy and atmosphere, well, most of the energy can already be preserved if we declare the structure as sustainable. As the major energy that is utilized is mostly to maintain the thermal comfort of the user within the built environment. Since we are harnessing the solar energy in the form using the solar panels, which also act as a canopy on the roof, and they provide power to the entire structure. The natural light and ventilation were given prime importance to attain the idea of a green building and sustainability. And passive strategies used to maintain the microclimate of the place decreases the cooling load on the building. And a cooling system that uses the geothermal energy at night is used to cool the building during the day. The materials that were used for the construction of the structure were acquired locally, and this helped in reducing the carbon footprint and was economically beneficial. The material used was yellow sandstone, and it is used to provide protection from extreme heat during the day and warmth during evening hours. The darker Jodhpur stone were used for the transom windows in the classrooms, as they are more stronger and they provide more support to the structure. And to allow enough room for ventilation, the drawings were revised to make the classrooms and other offices bigger in size, and the courtyard was used. The courtyard was designed in order to function as a central space. The priority was majorly given to acquire the local talents, and keeping this in mind, even the uniform of the students were designed using the local ajrak, which is actually a form of woodblock printing on textiles, with the goal of encouraging the girls to feel pride in their culture, cultural heritage, and the regional craftsmanship. So the use of locally available talented artisans were also the use of locally available talented artisans were also involved, and they also contributed in the development of the school. Coming to the green building strategies and concepts that we analyzed and that could be used in the design, we have categorized them in different categories. The first category would be sustainable site. So while designing, we should try to minimize the impervious areas and try to ways to get water to infiltrate the site, and then controlling the storm water and harvesting rainwater becomes another strategy. The maximizing open spaces with providing hardscapes with vegetated areas in between, and then the density radius of 0.5 miles, and then trying to notice that it includes the infrastructure for the basic amenities, reduction of light pollution, then using roof with high SRI material, mosaic tile, using green roof, and providing natural rainwater filtration, which insulation reflecting heat and combating urban island heat effect, then usage of solar panels to harness the natural resources that we have. Then coming to the water efficiency, the use of efficient water fixtures, then the using harvested non-potable water in toilets, and planting native plants and trees, as they would be requiring less maintenance and would also help to regain the natural habitat. Coming to energy and atmosphere, the most of the building design depends on the building form and orientation. If we do that right, then it would help in reducing the cooling load on the structure. So one of the ways which can be done is minimizing the western exposure to the surface, then usage of pre-natural energy, effective building envelope design to provide insulation and reduce energy use, using stored thermal energy in the building system, generating on-site energy, use of solar panels to generate green power, then maximize the exposure to take benefit of sun for daylight and passive solar heating. Then materials and resources. The focus should be to use locally available materials. Then trying to reuse, trying the 3 R's, reuse, recycle, and renew. Well, many times there are chances that the recycled materials that we think we are using is sustainable. Well, if we do not consider if we do not consider the factors required while they are being recycled, and if we are using it anyway, then maybe that recycled material is not sustainable in our context. Like if we are acquiring a material that we think is recycled from miles away, so it may not be sustainable in our case. Then considering new technology, design and construction decisions, and implementing it with traditional wisdom. Then coming to the indoor environment quality, adequate ventilation and daylighting, use of low emitting materials because of the reduced off-gassing of harmful contaminants, then installation of operable windows, and making sure that there's a visual connectivity between the natural landscape and the user, so that it could promote inclusivity, and also along with maintaining the privacy of the user. And the connection between the occupant and the nature would increase the comfort and productivity of the users. Coming next, we have how to incorporate these strategies in terms of design. First, we have orientation. If the structure is oriented in consideration to the contextual and climatic factors, keeping in mind the flow of wind for natural ventilation, diffuse sunlight, and mechanical dependence would lower considerably. One of the major issues that we can find in the modern building design is the lack of open spaces, which in vernacular architecture were very prominent. In traditional form, courtyard is an important element following the inward planning strategy. The courtyard also acted as thermodynamic sink, maintaining the microclimate of the structure. So if we suppose, and if you are talking about the vernacular modern architecture, so how we can implement the courtyard form into the modern architecture, or how can we transform the courtyard with modern technologies? So here are some strategies that could be done, like courtyard along with retractable ceiling could be used according to the user comfort and the climate of the time. Then courtyard plus water harvesting, which we have seen in the case study of the school in Rajasthan. Then another is courtyard plus flooring material. If we used high SRI materials as the flooring, so it would maintain the indoor environment. It would maintain the microclimate of the structure. Then courtyard plus vegetated areas, which could be pervious and allow rainwater filtration and reduce the urban and heat island effect. Coming to one of the essential element of vernacular architecture, and the one element which is also used for aesthetic purposes along with other functions, the lattice screen or the jali. Well, the physical function of the jali is to reduce the amount of light admitted inside and to cut out its blinding glare, and it also allows natural ventilation. So the ongoing trend of using jalis as a green facade, which is a vernacular modern architecture identity, makes it an almost integral part of a sustainable development. arched openings. Well, arches are the structural element in a building, and this architectural element provides an opening to allow light and ventilation to the areas enclosed. Vaulted ceilings are profiled concrete ceilings, which forms the part of a building structural frame. The shape enables a larger surface area of the material to be exposed, optimizing access to the thermal mass, which attenuate internal heat energy gain. It provides thermal comfort along with improved daylighting and ventilation. To hold the essence of vernacular architecture blended with modernity, the installation of solar panels such as shading devices gives it a new approach, as we have seen in the case study. Also, awnings and planting trees, native plants, provides shade, maintaining the microclimate. In the diagram that we can see on the right, it clearly defines the different strategies, passive shading strategies that are combined to gain a thermal comfort within the interiors of the house. Like deciduous trees is planted in order to get the winter sun inside, as the leaves would shed it leave during the winter. Then we can also see that ventilated roof space has been created to maintain the insulation and avoid heat gain. Fenestration in buildings play a very important role. So for example, transom windows allow light and help in ventilation by letting out hot air from the interiors. The cold air being dense lies low, whereas the hot air being lighter rises up and moves out. The another important vernacular element in Rajasthan that we observe is Ajharokha. So basically, people would think that it is an aesthetic element, but whereas it also have a function, like it is basically an overhanging balcony that's enclosed and is designed to accomplish air ventilation and keep the interior temperature subdued. It is fashioned by forming small perforations in the building in a manner that it naturally cools down the building in a hot and arid place, which can be transformed into bay windows under vernacular modern architecture and as a vernacular modern entity. Static ventilation makes use of the air movement by forming cavities and openings in the building's structure and envelope that are sufficiently elevated to permit the warm air to discharge. Like at the building top, negative pressure draws out denser, colder exterior air through low-level openings in the structure, which helps in maintaining the thermal comfort inside the building. The next strategy that can be used is green roofing. Well, green roofing could be done using high SRI materials on terrace floor to reflect heat back, and the lesser and costly and readily available option to achieve green roofing is putting potted plants on terrace. This helps in the reducing the cooling load of the building, and the structure does not gain much heat. Based on the observations and results, we can successfully conclude that sustainable development of rural areas could be done by native construction techniques and the traditional wisdom, along with the addition of the sustainable green building strategies and concepts. The new and modern technologies must be introduced, but in a minimalistic way, so as to add value to the traditional system and not overpower it. Major materials that are to be used in sustainable construction should be locally available, and the construction should be as simple as possible. local architecture, cultural heritage, vernacular architecture should be the key that promotes good health of the residents and create positivity and inclusivity among the people. Vernacular architecture is the time-honored, truly sustainable architecture that, in its multitudinous manifestations, has evolved over centuries, changing or adapting when necessary to variable environments and the nature of family and social growth. Thank you very much.